This video is not intended for children and contains spoilers. Watch on your own discretion.
Narwhal.
Star.
Visitors are prohibited from bringing weapons into the...
What are you doing?
I know what you did.
I hate magic. I'm gonna destroy it. Magic's the worst, and the people that use it are idiots.
I made the mistake of trusting you, believing you were my friend.
What the hell pissed him off?
I don't know.
Well, here we go again. Yet another show that had an interesting premise that face-planted at the finish line. You know, I don't like doing this. None of my videos are monetized, and that's by choice. I want to like these shows, I really do. But if they're going to continue portraying very serious topics, they need to be handled correctly. Can't just include something and then say you've made brave and nuanced commentary. I'll start with Echo Creek, the boring Earth town that Mark is from. It establishes how he and Star met and how Star is an outsider, but the show just keeps insisting that we watch dumb human shit while there's a whole multiverse of imagination we could be watching instead. There was actually an interesting subplot about how Marco becomes disillusioned with a sensei. He realizes this guy was not only a loser, but a fraud who never advanced beyond green belt. I don't know much about karate, but the fact that sensei wasn't even a black belt, let alone the red belt that he claimed to be, should have tipped him off. This was a wake-up call to move on with his life. Like sensei, if he stays in boring old Echo Creek, you know, like the show seems to do, he will stagnate and die. This plays rather well into his later obsession with Muni and aspirations for greater things. But then, sensei just kinda sticks around for the entire show? He played his role, why is he still here? He's depressing to think about, and he's a shitty, annoying character at this point, so can we just move on already? When it comes to Earth, it would have been a good use of the place to have Marco compare the safety of home to the ever-growing danger of the multiverse. Always unsure if he'd see his parents again, something like that. But no, it's never used in any meaningful way. We do learn that there's an ancient portal in Echo Creek, and that's likely where the original Newmans came from, but despite this being an incredibly important historical and scientific discovery, literally no one cares.
If this is the magic well, it's leading to these boats traveling here.
Avalanche explosion!
Yeah, that's it! Star, if the magic well connects Earth and Muni, then what if the first Newmans were actually humans?
Marco, less talky, more trashy!
Seriously? No, seriously?
Does anyone else find it weird that Muni fashion seems to be regressing, by the way? They started as pilgrims, then devolved into Renaissance. Hell, one of them looks like a fucking pirate. And then they devolve further into medieval. Doesn't really matter because it's not plot relevant, but it's something I noticed. Speaking of, why is Buff Frog Russian? I have no problem with recycling accents since there's only so many ways one could sound when they're speaking English. But he has a Russian name, too.
My name is Yevgeny Bogoyabov.
The settlers weren't Russian. They were from California, so what gives? Actually, while we're on the topic of Buff Frog, can we talk about his children? Little gives him a bag of tadpoles as a bribe to come work for him again, but these aren't Buff Frog's kids. They're just random frogs. Where the hell did Ludo get these? Did he steal them from another frog? There's some disturbing implications here that no one seems to care about. I also find it rather odd and cruel that they'd never use magic to separate the conjoined twins. Did that not bother anyone else? Like, this isn't funny, it's just sad. It's like those dragons in Camelot. Getting back to Marco, remember that time he spent 16 years isolated in Fallout New Vegas, where he had to likely kill to survive? Time works differently there, so he was gone for about 5 minutes in Earth time. He's suddenly 14 again, and this doesn't seem to have any lasting effect on him. He hasn't seen his family or friends in nearly 2 decades, hasn't had a proper meal, and he's had to struggle with the possibility that he could die out here or otherwise never make it home, and when he finally does, whatever, nothing wrong here, back to normal, I guess. You fucking what, mate? He should have had a nervous fucking breakdown. He should need therapy after this. Meanwhile, the show acts like this was insignificant. By the end of his isolation, he should be a completely changed man. A 14-year-old thrown into what Marco himself constantly refers to as the most dangerous dimension isn't going to make it out unscathed, and yet that's seemingly what happens. His family and friends don't seem to care all that much either, or at least the ones he still hangs out with. Whatever happened to these guys anyway? They were his best friends until Star came along, then they just disappeared and the show even called itself out for it.
Ferguson! Alfonso! I haven't talked to you guys all year, but you're always there in the background doing your thing!
I just don't see the point in writing these guys into the story if they're not going to tag along for the adventures. They join one, and then that's it. You could have easily made Marco a friendless loner, and the show would have played out the same. In fact, I think it would have made more sense and given more weight to Star being forced into his life. Not only that, but I would have rather seen more of them instead of Janna. Janna is the worst character. No, sorry, that's inaccurate. She's the worst human character. She's this creepy stalker who constantly steals from Marco, yet she's always forgiven and invited to all the shenanigans. The one thing she had going for her was the interest in the occult. As far as we know, there's no magic on Earth, only in other dimensions. And yet she studies ancient witchcraft and sorcery, actually managing to resurrect someone. Who she resurrected wasn't important. They were only doing that activity as a plot device for Luna's reveal. Let me say that again. Earth magic, despite never being explored again, is real. This is an interesting, world-changing piece of lore the show doesn't give two shits about. Why? Even if it was just the foundation for more world-building, you're sitting on a deposit of printer ink here, and you're doing nothing with it. Like, Ludo is a Kappa. Those are real mythological creatures, implying that they've come here before to fuck with us, because they're assholes. But that also calls the validity of human wizards and demigods into question. Like, what if Hercules, for instance, was a Salarian like Mina who somehow got stranded on Earth during the Crusade? I don't think the timeline matches up for that, but it's just an example. Like, there's a lot you could do with this, and it's just nothing. It's never mentioned again. See, if they did more of this stuff with Janna's character, she'd at least make up for how disturbing and unlikable she is. That would have been an extremely interesting character who would have been a nice contrast for the more fantastical magic users like Star. Earth magic would have seemed grittier and less refined in comparison. But no, Janna never does anything cool or useful again, so like, what was the fucking point? She steals Marco's wallet and fingerprints! That joke got old pretty fucking quickly, and yet she remains a main character for the rest of the show. Even the finale felt the need to include her. I feel like she just really doesn't belong here. You can't try to convey complex relationships only to constantly cut back to this toxic one-sided relationship that is never addressed.
Who was that? No one, shut up. Why do we even hang out with Janna?
Tom was toxic and one-sided, but he actually got character development and his thing with Star actually went somewhere. I see a lot of people say Star was the bad guy here, but really they were both awful to each other. Meanwhile, Janna doesn't get anything. She remains a stagnant, uncomfortable character throughout. Tom, on the other hand, well, there's a lot to unpack here. I stand by what I said in that he got the most character development, but I feel like it wasn't enough to redeem him. He starts out as a one-dimensional rival character for Marco, constantly casting curses on the guy and literally fucking exploding anytime someone tells him no. Over time, however, he starts exploding less and less, and eventually leaves Star because he realizes he's a fucking prick and they shouldn't be together. That's cool and all, but seeing as his primary role in the show was cartoonish rival, ending the series on racial allegories, war, and genocide, it's a complete waste for Tom not to rally the forces of the underworld, being their prince and all, to reinforce Muni during their time of need. It's mentioned before that despite his royal lineage, he's a monster like everyone else.
When I get on an elevator with a stranger, I'm a monster. Just like all of you. I'm a rich monster, yeah, but I'm a monster.
So seeing a monster defend the realm of people who dislike monsters would have been significant. His mother literally controls the weather. That would have been really fucking helpful in the final battle. You'd also think demons would have their own brand of magic, but other than unique portals, we don't really see anything beyond the curses he puts on Marco. Like, where's the destructive stuff? Where's the meat? On one hand, the fact that he took the time to reflect and realize that he was toxic was nice. On the other, it took him way too long to come to that conclusion, and his character just kind of lingers the entire time, not doing anything to progress the plot. An arc for a pointless character is still a waste of our time. Now, let's throw all of that out the window and talk about the Blood Moon Curse.
You're both cursed. The curse chooses two souls to be eternally bound under the light of the Blood Moon. And I took you in hopes that it would choose us, but it didn't. It chose you and Marco instead.
Wait, so we're cursed and you knew about it?
Yeah, but I kind of thought you knew too.
No, Tom, I didn't know. How would I have known? I don't want my destiny determined by some creepy curse.
It says here that moon curses are easily broken.
When's the next blood moon?
Around 665 years from now. Oh, right. You don't live that long.
Right!
Holy shit. I don't know what to say. Tom is irredeemable and deserves to die for this. This is two counts of assault on a meta level. He intended it to bind him and Star, not Star and Mark. This was set up and intentional. It just didn't pan out the way Tom wanted it to. He knew exactly what this curse was and what he was doing. Again, if you remove this from his character, I think Tom is well written for what's there. Albeit, what is there is boring and underutilized, but the Blood Moon thing completely and utterly ruins him. Fuck this guy with a rusty pitchfork, he sucks. Next time you see someone arguing that Star was awful to him, remind them of the soul rape curse. Seriously, this isn't just bad writing. The fact that Marco and Star don't seem to care all that much beyond actually breaking the curse shows us some very unfortunate insight on the writers. They're not even mad at Tom at all for this clear violation of free will. This sort of thing is not okay, and whoever wrote this episode is not okay. I am genuinely concerned for whoever approved this. Moving on from that dumpster truck of yikes, the show starts off with the antagonist of Ludo, an incompetent villain who wants to steal the wand and take over Munich. It uses Ludo's ambushes as an excuse to explore new locations, so that's also cool. But while Ludo gets a lot of character development early on, it abruptly hits a brick wall and stops progressing. After being defeated one too many times and stranded in the void, he finds his way to an unknown wilderness. He domesticates the animals around him, which is no small feat given that he's as tall as I was until high school, and he's the only person in existence to have hands appropriately sized for the Nintendo Switch. He becomes self-sufficient and one with nature, showcasing that he's not stupid. He may not be great in a fight and he's impulsive, but if nothing else, he's extremely adaptable. For a king who's presumably used to comfort and safety, it's interesting to see him take all of this so well. Stuff happens, and he eventually burns Star's spellbook, killing Glossaric. But Glossaric being Glossaric, he comes back because of course he does. Only the good die young. He gets over his obsession with acquiring the wand and pulls a "there's nothing left for me out here," which is later pulled by a joke character, ironically symbolizing the decline of the show's writing. We later learn that Ludo comes from an abusive family, and despite being the runt, he was the only one brave enough to stand up to his father, who he stole the castle from, by the way. Again, it proves that Ludo isn't just some Looney Tunes villain and can actually pull off some crazy shit when he wants to. He's just shit in a fight against a magic user, which is understandable. As Ludo retires from his lifelong quest, his brother Dennis, who always respected Ludo for standing up to their dad, goes looking for him. This is where Ludo's arc stops being good and just kind of falls off a cliff. Dennis finds him where he lives with creepy mannequins of his parents. Ludo's talked to voices in his head before, but back then there was actually someone talking to him. Now he's just schizophrenic. That's not how mental illness works. Dennis doesn't make much progress in helping Ludo get over his trauma either. What's also weird is that the mannequins move around and seem to possess other objects when one mannequin is destroyed, implying that they're actually alive, but their parents aren't dead or anything, and I don't think Toth would waste his time trolling Ludo at this point, so what the hell even was that? Ludo starts the series as a laughable punching bag. He transforms into a badass survivor capable of briefly taking over Munich. Ludo ends the series as a mentally ill nobody who seemingly has no aspirations and nothing to look forward to other than playing with Dennis. And Dennis doesn't seem to want anything in life other than being around his brother. Am I missing something here? Because this is just sad for the sake of being sad. Sure, Ludo wanted to take over the world with the wand, but he never actually achieved that goal. The worst he did was be a mediocre narcissistic king for like less than a week. And I'd argue he was still a better monarch than Star would be. Heyo! My point is, it felt like this was supposed to be a hopeful conclusion for him, but it had the opposite effect for me. He never succeeded in his evil plans, and his failed attempts didn't hurt anyone besides Glossaric, who, let's be honest, deserved it. His subplot doesn't go anywhere. They turn him into a confused shell of his former self and expect us to feel anything but bleak. Ludo deserved way better than this. Also, there was an episode where Marco briefly had a sapient monster arm, and when they got rid of it, it said this.
You'll never get rid of me! I'm part of you now!
You can treat the symptoms, but you'll never cure the virus!
The arm never comes into play again, but there was an interesting theory I heard that would have been a good use of this wasted subplot. The wand changes appearance based on whoever wields it, see, and Marco's wand looks weirdly ominous, similar to Ludo's wand, but as the theory points out, it only changed when Marco grabbed it with his right hand, ergo the cursed one. Again, though, this never really goes anywhere.
Such wasted potential.
Eventually, however, we're introduced to a new antagonist, Toffee.
I presume you're the one they call the Lizard.
Yes, but you may call me Toffee.
Toffee? How is that any better?
Ugh, I fucking hate that stupid name. Like, it's not even funny. It would make sense if he was more of a gelatinous being, but he's not. He's a mysterious intellectual, or at least he is compared to every other incompetent villain we've seen, which is a trope I really don't like. Toffee isn't actually all that smart or cunning, he just looks good compared to absolute retards. There's a fine line between characters like Thrawn and characters like Toffee. Both of them command armies and are only thwarted by people who wield powers that they themselves don't have. The key difference is, Thrawn is a brilliant strategist. He was playing 4D chess while the rest of us were playing checkers, and he only loses because the Force seems to have a will of its own and dictates the outcome of history. This is ultimately why Kreia wanted to destroy the Force, because if the Force doesn't like you, you're destined to fail. Basically, Thrawn only loses because he's not the protagonist. He does everything right, and it's not enough because the writer is God. Toffee, on the other hand, seems to only rely on brute forcing his way through obstacles because he's invincible, never actually needing to have a plan or strategize. He's like Deadpool in this regard. Because he's never truly in danger, he's sloppy. But Bacxaber, I hear you say, because no one can pronounce my fucking username apparently. He had an elaborate plan to overthrow Ludo. Sure he did, but the plan only works because Ludo's men are idiots. It's much less to do with the fact that Toffee was smart. Thrawn's plans work because he can think outside of the box. Other than cheap jokes that, stormtroopers can't aim, even though they are ordered to keep them alive.
Commander, tear this ship apart until you found those plans, and bring me the passengers. I want them alive!
The Empire is not incompetent. Need I remind you that they somehow won a fight in a bottleneck hallway while they entered single file. Toffee's plan, singular, works because everyone around him bends to the will of the plot. Are we all cleared up? No? Fuck you, I'm moving on. He convinces Ludo to hire him, where he gradually degrades the trust and loyalty of Ludo's men, ending with him overthrowing the King of Monsters. See, this is really promising. So, how does the show fuck it up? Well, to explain that, I need to explain further context. In the past, Toffee was a general of a revolution to take over Mute. Not because monsters are discriminated against, which they are, but because Toffee wanted power. I'd argue that's a secondary motive, but I really don't see how this war would have done anything for the primary. That being, he wants to destroy magic entirely because it's the only thing that can kill reptilians.
Aren't you looking small?
Regenerating from a single hand has not been easy.
Normally, I'd say it would be a new brain, therefore a new person, but souls are a thing, so never mind. Hey, this is me from editing. Why does she have the wand? It's not like they all got their own. It's the same one passed down. I guess it did just die, but again, why would it go to her specifically? I suppose killing the magic users would help, but it doesn't really remove the possibility of it still being used against you. No one knowing magic doesn't mean it doesn't exist. Plus, there would still be the High Commission. Don't worry, I will get to them. He fights Star, loses, gets her to disenchant her wand by holding Marco hostage, and dies in the impending explosion because that's a thing, apparently. Not all magic can cause permanent damage to him, as he regrows his arm from an earlier blast, but I guess this was enough to put him down because plot reasons. Ludo then uses his severed arm as a wand for himself. Jesus Christ, that's dark. Bravo. More of this stuff, please. This is cool. His soul haunts Ludo, however, psychically telling him to do things. Ludo was already not all there, and his sanity drifts even further after having to survive in the wilderness for an extended period of time. Huh. Both protagonist and antagonist went through the same experience. Coincidence? Probably, but I find it interesting. Too bad the show never brings it up. If you were going to have Star learn wandless magic later in the series anyway, I don't see why we needed to cling to the wand. I feel like this was just a plot contrivance so they'd give it to Eclipsa later, as she states that she'd never learned to cast by hand. But given that she's supposed to be the black sheep of the family, I feel like it would have made way more sense to have her be the only known queen to cast by hand rather than use the heirloom. Just one more thing to have her stand out from the others, and by foregoing tradition, further alienating herself. It also would have made her live up to the reputation of being an extremely powerful witch, something that hasn't really been fulfilled in the final product. It's implied that every queen makes up their own spells to add to the book, and Eclipsa made some of the darkest and most powerful ones. That being said, these spells are not limited to their creator, nor are they exclusively recorded for historical value. Anyone can learn them. Technically, any queen who came after could match or surpass her power level, especially since she's reliant on the wand, and those aren't necessary for casting magic. I'd say Eclipsa's my favorite character, and it's partially because she and Tom are the only characters to get full arcs, and because of Blood Moon thing, I really don't ever want to think of Tom again. My issue with her is that she's married to the goddamn Demon King who murders and eats people, and the show never addresses it. I don't give a shit that he's a vegetarian now that doesn't bring back the people he's eaten. Remember when Eclipsa had a diplomatic visit from a royal family of another kingdom, and they were so horrified and offended by the countless reminders of Globgor's innumerable crimes against humanity that were set in places of honor around the palace, that the only way Eclipsa could save the Alliance was to show them that Globgor was imprisoned, and swear to them that he'd never get out, and none of that was ever mentioned again? Even her outfit is a compelling part of her character. Unlike Moon, she doesn't wear a crown because she's not about that kind of posh life and following rigid tradition. In the same way that Solaria doesn't wear fancy clothes because that's not who she is. She's a warrior plain and simple. Eclipse's outfit represents progression away from an outdated monarchy system. She didn't deserve to be locked away. At no point was she labeled an incompetent leader, just an unpopular one. What's the worst she's done? Creating death magic? That's not inherently bad, especially since they never implied she actually used it on anyone, and if she did, it was probably only against the reptilians. It would be overkill and a waste of her own energy to use it on anything less. I want to say the racial allegory of the humans oppressing monsters thing was handled decently, no different than most medieval fantasy settings I've consumed, but the show doesn't exactly define what a monster is. Is this a monster? Yes. Is this a monster? Not really. They're wild animals, and the show only cares about sapient ones. I'd sooner label these ones creatures. Is this a monster? No, this is a member of the High Commission, beings made of pure magic who themselves hate monsters for some reason. Is this a monster? No, this is a spell. Is this a monster? Yes. Is this a monster? No, this is a spell. It's no less alive than this one, though. You can see how this shit gets confusing. Furthermore, I would classify monsters into two categories. Reptilians and everyone else, since the reptiles are the only ones who are indestructible. There's nothing inherently wrong with the reptilians. They're not all evil, at least I don't think so. Do we ever see a reptilian who's not a prick in this show? Problem is, wizards don't seem to be a thing in Muni. Only the royal family uses magic, meaning the reptiles could kill the family and there'd be no one else to prevent their takeover. There's a huge power imbalance here, and there's only one thing in existence that could hold them back if they decided to, well, I don't know, conquer the multiverse, and that thing is in short supply. That got me thinking. Mina's immortal since she's a Salarian knight, basically a thunder warrior from 40k, mental instability and all. She was alive during this time, so why didn't she just use her overpowered sword to kill Toffee and his army? I don't see why Moon needed to learn Eclipse's death spells instead. Mina could have kicked this smug asshole back to whatever swamp he crawled out of, and all of this would have been over. Would Mina have stopped at just him? Of course not, she wants total monster genocide because the Salarian knights are driven insane by their magical powers, but regardless, I don't understand where Mina was during all of this, and why she wasn't the one leading the charge. Now, it's not Mina's fault she's so bloodthirsty, it's whatever Salaria did to her, but this is another justification the monsters have in general for hating the Mumans and not wanting to be ruled by them. The Mumans are violent supremacists who either want to exile or kill the competition rather than work alongside them. Personally, I forgive Mina for the same reason I forgave Jasper. They're symptoms of the problem, not the source of it. Mina's village was built on a monster's nest, but the village itself didn't seem to know that. All she knows is that her home got attacked one day, and this is a common occurrence throughout the land. It's unsafe, and the wilderness must be tamed. Mina joined the Salarian Initiative because she saw an opportunity to protect her homeland and her people. Over time, the magic corroded her mind, eventually creating the tragic villain that we see today. I see tons of people complaining about how Mina was an uninteresting, lackluster antagonist because we could have had Toffee instead. Yeah, he comes back and gets killed at some point, again, even though this wasn't caused by Eclipse's death spells. By all accounts, he should be able to heal from this, despite how grotesque it looks. But no, the show decides he's dead. Thing is, I don't fully agree with the majority here. Yes, I would have absolutely liked to see more of Toffee. He's awesome and shouldn't have died here, but Mina is an acceptable replacement. If she just stayed as the wacky knight that used to serve Moon, then yeah, that would have sucked, but she has an interesting backstory that gives her proper motive for everything she does. Like my opinion on Mass Effect's ending, I agree it could have been better in this regard, but I'm satisfied with what we got. Now, I'm referring to Mina replacing Toffee, by the way. I'm not satisfied with how the show ended. Now, sure, both of Toffee's goals are evil, I'm not defending him at all, but his army has every reason to support his cause. The Butterflies are terrible rulers, and they need to be dethroned.
No offense, King, but you're a terrible king!
You're right! I stink at this!
Toffee wouldn't be a great king either, but when both options are shit, who do you support? Mina isn't the only one who's mysteriously absent here. Where the fuck is Romulus? This dude hates monsters and is able to freeze anyone he wants in a crystal, regardless of how powerful they are. He froze the Demon King, managed to actually freeze a black hole, and one of his equally powerful colleagues. He could have easily put down Toffee's rebellion. For some reason, the High Commission favors the royal family and are in constant communication with the acting queen, so there's no reason why they wouldn't have played their ultimate fuck you I win card here. While we're on the topic of Timeout Guy, he has his whole character arc early in the show where he learns restraint and begins to get over his paranoia. This doesn't go anywhere at all, and he continues to be a paranoid bigot for the rest of the show, constantly harassing and accusing Eclipse of crimes just for being a monster sympathizer. Fuck monsters, says the green man with snakes for hands and a rock for a head who works for a satanic goat. Wait a minute. So Glosseric created a guy who was destined to die, unlike the rest of the Immortal High Commission, and Lekmek had no say in the matter?
You are the worst person I know.
Star.
He pays for your food and rescued you from certain death, and this is how you repay
her.
And to add insult to injury, you defecate all over
her
yard. And what really bothers me is you pretend you're this deep guy who
wants to help Star.
When all you do is
fuck around.
God, you're pretentious. And you delude yourself by thinking you're some great
teacher,
even though you're terrible, which isn't nearly as bad as your failure as a father. How's that son of yours you never see? But you know what? I could forgive all of that, all of it, if you weren't such a bore. That's the worst of it.
Glossaric.
You're just a big, sad
pudding-eating
bore.
Jesus Christ, Glossaric's a dick. Gloss-a-dick, if you will. He's basically the living embodiment of the spellbook, even though the book acts independently of him. No, it doesn't make sense, thank you for asking. The show begins with him being a jerk to Marco, somewhat understandable since he doesn't have the authority to be reading the book, but then he just acts like this to everyone throughout the entire series, and he doesn't freak out at Ludo for both stealing and reading the book. No matter the stakes, he just sits on his ass, gives some cryptic clue about whatever's going on, and then stuffs his face with food. He claims he's a neutral party, I find that hard to believe, but whatever, which is just a shitty excuse to have him not solve everything immediately. Where was he during Globgor's rampage? He doesn't have a side. Where was he when Toffee attacked? He doesn't give a shit. He's neutral. But where was he when the nobles ordered the extermination of monsters? Teaching the nobles magic so they could buff their knights. He was right behind that fucking idea. If he's so neutral, why does he help the Butterfly family at all? What's he hoping to achieve? The show never explains this. I've heard a theory that since he's basically God, that he knows the future. So all of history and everything he's done is to get him to the point where he can die. This has all been an elaborate suicide attempt. That doesn't make sense to me, since I don't see why he couldn't just destroy magic by himself. Like, Star's not even that impressive and she can do it with some help. Yeah, did I not mention that yet? She destroys magic. So let me see if I got that right. So Toffee deserves to be dismembered and burned to death for wanting to do this, but when Star does it, she's a hero.
Right.
You know what the problem here is? Star is the main character and Toffee isn't. So naturally, anything she says or does is righteous and the show will take her side, including people who should know better. The only difference between the two is that Toffee wears the skulls of his enemies and Star doesn't.
Oh my God!
Mina was going to commit genocide, so to stop her, Star committed genocide. You know, if they went with Eclipse's plan, which is as follows...
You go over there, make amends with your daughter, and the three of us go back together to unleash a wicked bunch of nasty business on those warriors.
This would have been a great opportunity to bring the original Meteora back to fight in her father's place, putting aside her issues with Marco and Moon to defend their family and homeland.
Mina. Solarian warrior. Monster slayer.
The prophecy had been fulfilled.
Mina
had indeed returned to
Muni
to reclaim
her
army and impose
her
dominance. Death awaited all who stood in
her
way. So it was that a new alliance was formed out of desperation. Sworn enemies joined forces to combat a greater threat.
But no, that would have made sense. Can't have that.
Eclipse refused to put Meteora down despite everything she's done, which I totally understand. She instead just reverts her into a baby, essentially killing her but also giving her a second chance and the upbringing she lacked the first go-around. But the weird thing is, she's not completely erased. She still hates Marco despite not knowing why, so it's implied that she could be restored at some point. But because that plot point doesn't go anywhere since she's just an infant for the rest of the story, it makes her a boring, pointless character. Yeah, she's still useful as a prop for Eclipse's character in a once this is all over we can be a family again type of way, but they insisted on including Baby Meteora in the final climax as if she knows what she's doing. This form shouldn't even be possible from humans until adolescence, and according to Moon, takes intense training to achieve. But nope, she can just do it instantly and plays a pivotal role in the great multiversal genocide.
Well, for what it's worth, I think you made the right choice.
Shut the fuck up, Keith David, you aren't even the real Glossary. Solaria shows up for this too, which makes zero sense. We only ever see her one other time, so it's not like she had a change of heart. Also, they retconned her design. Doesn't really matter, but I noticed. As far as the audience knows, she lived and died a conqueror.
I lost my mother too, when I was not much older than you.
Here's how I would have fixed this. As the ghosts fade away, either have Solaria be the first or the last to go. If she's first, it's as if she's disgusted with her granddaughter being a monster, so she refused to stick around, making her character consistent throughout. If she's the last to leave, she's forced to watch pretenders to the throne destroy her secret weapon, and her champion get pummeled into the ground by the Firstborn. Solaria would have to watch everything she built up collapse. Since she's already dead, this is about as much justice as the monsters can get. Instead, Solaria is just cool with everything now and hates Mina. The ghosts don't talk, so we're never given an explanation for this sudden change of character. It's like they wanted to have a heartfelt moment but didn't want to put any work into it, because as it stands, this is just confusing. You know, what Star did is even worse than what Doomguy did. He's doing the right thing, up until 2016 at least, for the wrong reasons. He's fighting a one-man war against the forces of evil.
He said it! He said it!
Not because he cares about humanity, and if he does, it's never been obvious. No, he initially did it with self-defense, and then later ventured back into hell after they killed his pet rabbit. No, I'm serious, that's actually his motive. But eventually, Earth starts to harness hell's infinite power to solve our resource and energy crises. Hating anything relating to hell, Doomguy insists on destroying these sources of power despite the fact that he's causing irreparable damage to society by doing so. At some point, the player is supposed to realize that Doomguy is a lost cause, not the savior he's often propped up to be. Doom is self-aware about this. This show, in comparison, is not self-aware about this. Star has caused irreparable damage to the multiverse, genociding trillions who were either made of magic or dependent on it. Star has stranded everyone to the dimension they were currently in, to that dimension forever. Think of all the traitors, all the workers, all the diplomats, lost to Star's hubris. You were in that arcade when it happened? You're stuck there forever now, hope you have a lot of quarters. You were at St. Olga's? Have fun running away from the security goons for the rest of your life. There's no way home, and there never will be again. Something else she did that pissed me off is that she used the last ounce of magic to fuse Earth and Muni together so that she wouldn't lose Marco. We now have to share our planet with a backwards medieval society full of dangerous mythical creatures. It's unclear if the size of the planet increased to accommodate things, but if it did, I presume that would have astrological consequences? I'm not Carl Sagan, so I'm not going to make scientific claims I'm not confident in. Whether it did or didn't, we now have double the population and half the resources. Most of Muni looked pretty barren, and the only food we ever see them eat is either meat or corn. So yeah, they didn't have much to share to begin with. I've seen comparisons of Star to Thanos, but the ironic thing is Star is worse, because not only did she cause mass genocide, but she also somehow managed to create a resource problem by doing so.
Congratulations, you're a failure.
The worst part is, now there's literally nothing that can stop the reptilians. No amount of bullets or bombs will be enough to kill them should they be a problem. Though Toffee is dead and can't be resurrected, he ultimately won. But the show treats this ending like a bittersweet one. It's not. This is a horrifying bad ending that somehow managed to be worse than Steven's fucking ending. How do you even manage that? Going into this show, I was warned that it was going to upset me, but dear lord, I was not prepared. Toffee also implies that he saw into the future, which doesn't add up since he's never given the opportunity, nor is he capable of magic.
Only I know how this all turns out.
Was he working with Glossaric? Kinda seemed like it. But like the monster arm thing, this is never brought up again. Hey, hold on a sec. The souls of the ancestors fade away when magic got destroyed, so does that mean souls were magic? Did Star just destroy the afterlife, too? Do you understand the weight behind that? It's not confirmed, or if it is, it was never confirmed in the show, so it doesn't count, but if she did, Star not only killed trillions of living people, but she also killed trillions of dead people. How the fuck? When all is said and murdered, they just let Mina walk away despite her insistence that she'll continue her crusade with or without Solarian powers. You destroyed magic in its entirety because of her, and yet she gets to fuck off to the forest like nothing happened.
What could you have possibly done worse than that?
They arrested Romulus at some point, but no one bothers to arrest Mina for treason. Sure, she's not a super soldier anymore, but she's still insane and focused on her deranged, violent goal. If you let her go, she's going to hurt someone or inspire someone else to go down the same ruinous path. Are you fucking kidding me? The thing that really gets me is that even if you take the genocide away, Star is still an unlikable asshole. But like I said, she's the protagonist, so this is never addressed.
I thought we were friends, but...
What? Oh, no! That's not what I meant! We're friends. I just don't have fun with you. But that is so fine, because it's not like you like having fun, right? Obviously. That's why you're alone all the time. No, you can't go!
Oh, I'm sorry.
You always mess things up!
Is that mean? I know that sounds mean. Oh, we got the wrong guy. Sorry, Reuben. Victimless crime.
What? You destroyed my home!
She turned some guy into a frog once, and now that magic's gone, he's stuck like that forever, assuming he's still alive. Didn't we have a whole movie about why doing that to someone makes you the bad guy? You have a very serious problem when Mabel from Gravity Falls is a better character than you.